Hi, I'm Susan. I'm from Worldpeacefull. And the last few days, I've been getting inspiration around North Korea and Donald Trump. And I was riding on my bike today and getting the feeling that I need to write a poem about this subject. Now, what I typically do is I don't like to look too much into the media because I don't want to bias the poetry that I write. I like the poetry to come up in its own creative way, so that I can gain insights into transforming conflict. So I will read you the poem that I wrote and then talk to you some more about peace. The poem is called "The Politics of Power Inspires the Rising Sun of Peace." I do not watch the media, as the mind is controlled by opinion pieces. The jigsaw pieces are in disarray. Not peaceful opinions that realise the big picture is a goodness of fit test rather than a shape changer. Instead, reducing it to a piecemeal to fill in time, a time filler to escape one's own life, to entertain with distracting sound bites, feeding fear, grief, anger as division, in the absence of a holistic worldview. The global chessboard divides white pieces from black, a good guy's and bad guy's vision of the world. As Chinese checkers takes as many pieces as possible in one move, as the winner takes all. Russian roulette challenges with deterrence, as mutually assured destruction, where both lose. American gridiron strategizes quick passes of subterfuge, to beat others in reaching a direct goal. Korea's story is a divided family mourning Ararang as lovers enslaved and torn apart by external interference, unable to reconcile their differences as love suicides as her soul is lost, heartbroken in a truly weakened state. For all defense readies for war, all war doctrines see an enemy. In a world divided along north-south, east-west doctrines, dividing to conquer. For the old paradigm fights the last Cold War as the globe is heating up. The climate has changed irreversibly. The ancient sage asks, is communism equality? Is capitalism freedom? How is this so? Are all equal in poverty at the feet of the elite? Is equal opportunity the user's pay of divided classes? For are we free to exploit the masses for the benefit of the few? What of the few fighting for supremacy, endangering the masses to suffer unforeseen consequences? Same, same, but different, she ponders. For the wise watch the same leopard trying to change its spots. Can one fight for freedom, or is one free when they do not fight? Which is might? Which is right? Which is the kite that flows with the thermals? Is power over or power within? Is energy derived by power? Is nuclear the genie in the bottle? Or is power how you direct energy? Tai Chi harmonizes universal energy within. For peace and power are mutually exclusive. One cannot exist in the same space as the other. The martial art of Aikido unifies life energy, combining forces, blending with the attacker's movements with minimal effort. For Sun Tzu's art of war asserts you are strong when weak and subdue the enemy without fighting. For what you resist persists and what you look at disappears. The martial art of Aikido uplifts the human spirit in harmony as the way. The path of personal development saves face in conflict. For you can bow the head in respect of virtues as valour, controlling aggression to do no harm releases the power within. To realise what you see in another is the shadow in yourself. For the enemy is always within. Fear, anger, and grief are the three horsemen of the arms industry attacking at night. Compassion, kindness, and truth are the three wise ones who recite arms holding a candle to enlighten what is hidden. As Tai Chi and Aikido reunite differences naturally, mastering energy realizes the philosophy of peace as harmony. As the rising sun of a renewable earth hears the clarion call trumpeting a new enlightenment as opposites in the end must unite. To identify the true self beyond space and time. So that's what I wrote today. Because as I was reflecting on this, I was going into Chinese philosophy. I was sort of finding myself reflecting on the Asian story and how they may see things, which led me to one of my early teachers who actually inspired me on the path that I'm on. He was a very early teacher whose name was Lao Tzu. And I was in London at the time. And I remember I was standing at the London Underground and I was just like everybody else looking at the posters that were lining the Underground station. And I remember seeing a sign for a philosophy course that said, when you notice this sign, you must be ready to come to a philosophy course. Now, I'd never been to one before. And I just thought, well, I might go along and have a look and see what I think. So I did. I went to this philosophy course and I sat in the course and I listened to a lot of Western philosophy. I Think, Therefore I Am was talked about. And I can remember a man talking about mankind. And as a woman, I had to say something. I said, I don't relate to mankind. And I wasn't trying to be difficult. I was just being honest at the time. I just don't relate to the word mankind. I think of men when I hear that word. And I remember someone in the audience saying to me that I was being politically correct, you know, and I didn't actually understand what they were talking about at the time. I thought, what? Politically correct? You know, I actually was just saying the literal truth as I understood it. I wasn't trying to insult men or anything like that. I suppose humankind would have been the word that I would have related to because it makes us all one. I didn't really want to see division along the lines of gender. Anyway, after the critique, I remember feeling, I think I'll leave. It's not really for me. And I started to walk out and I saw all these books. And there was a tiny little book and it had an old Chinese man sitting upon an ox. And something just compelled me to grab it, and I did. I picked it up and I had a look at it, and there were lots of sonnets, and I'm a poet myself, so I got drawn to it. And I started to look through it, and I could see a lot of wisdom in this writing. And I bought this tiny book, and this book changed my life. It actually led me to the Eastern philosophy, which I felt more resonated with who I am. So I want to introduce you to that and share with you my love of Lao Tzu just as an addition to this poetry, because I kind of feel it has resonance with what I've just written. And it also has a message for the world. So I thought I might just explain to you who Lao Tzu is. So I've had a look on the internet, so I'll read you something from the internet. Lao Tzu is widely considered to be the founder of Taoism. Some people call it Taoism. Some scholars suggest that he may not have actually existed historically, that he is a legend or mythical figure only, but many scholars of religion hold to the idea that he is, in fact, and a historical figure. Not much is known about him. He is widely credited with being the author of the most important text in Taoism, the Tao Te Ching. Some people pronounce it also as the Tao Te Ching. Although this is hard to prove historically, he lived during the 6th century BCE in the same period as Confucius. One of only two recorded stories about him tells of Confucius coming to visit him to get advice. He advised Confucius to give up his government job and his entire way of living. In fact, what he had said was to give everything up and follow the way, and Confucius couldn't, apparently, and they parted ways. A second story captures the essence or spirit of this religion's founder as he is understood and embraced by Taoists. This is a popular story in Chinese culture and often appears in religious artwork. According to the legend, Lao Tzu became frustrated with the wrong-headedness of people in China, especially the leaders. So he vowed to leave. He rode across the desert on a water buffalo and reached the border crossing. The border guard recognized him as a sage and pleaded with him not to leave China. Lao Tzu insisted he was leaving. The guard convinced him to at least write down his ideas before he left, so that future generations could benefit from them. He finally agreed to this and, a day or two later, returned to border crossing with a small sheaf of papers on which he had written his ideas, which he handed to the guard. The sage crossed the border out of China and disappeared forever. The sheaf of papers eventually became the Tao Te Ching, the most important book in Taoism. The legend captures the simplicity and humility of Taoism and its founder. Whether or not he actually lived historically, he did not ride in a fancy carriage or a majestic horse. Instead, he rode a common work animal. He had no concerns for leaving a legacy or for bolstering his reputation as a sage, and he had to be convinced to even write his ideas down for others to see. This type of non-attachment, simplicity, and humility are at the heart of Taoist philosophy. Apparently, he worked in the court of the emperor. He was in the library. He was a very knowledgeable man, but his lineage or his legacy, if you like, is really in the realm of mysticism. He wasn't a religious person. He was a mystic, a Chinese mystic. I'm going to read you some of the sonnets. The book that I found was written and translated by Richard Wellham, and it's a really excellent translation. So I've actually found that translation on the net, and I'm just going to read out things that attract my eye. They're small sonnets, so you'll just get an idea of the wisdom that this wonderful old man generated 600 years BC. So this is very ancient. He speaks of rulers. The best rulers are scarcely known by their subjects. The next best are loved and praised. The next are feared. The next despised. They have no faith in their subjects, so their subjects become unfaithful to them. When the best rulers achieve their purpose, their subjects claim the achievement as their own. Simplicity. If we could discard wisdom and sagacity, then people would profit 100-fold. If we could discard duty and justice, then loving relationships would form. If we could discard artifice and profit, then corruption and theft would disappear. Yet such remedies treat only symptoms, and so they are inadequate. People need personal remedies. Reveal your naked self. Embrace your original nature. Bind your self-interest. Control your desire. This next one is called Four Infinites, Infinities. Before the world exists, there is mystery. Silent, depthless, alone, unchanging, ubiquitous and ever moving. The mother of the world. I do not know its name, so I call it Tao. I do not know its limit, so I call it infinite. Being infinite, it flows away forever. Flowing away forever, it returns to the self. The self follows the way of the world. The world follows the way of nature. Nature follows the way of Tao. Tao is the way. Tao is infinite. Therefore, nature is infinite. Therefore, the world is infinite. Therefore, the self is infinite. There are four infinities, and the self is one of them. The next one is called being the female. Knowing the male, being the female. Being the course through which flows the world, one embraces unfailing love and is again as a newborn. Knowing the light, being the dark, being the world, one becomes unerring love and returns to Tao. Knowing honor, being humble, being the valley of the world, love suffices, and one is as unshaped wood. When wood is shaped, it becomes tools. Used by the sage, tools become powerful. So a good carpenter wastes little. This one's called blindness. Those who wish to change the world according with their desire cannot succeed. The world is shaped by Tao. It cannot be shaped by self. If one tries to shape it, one damages it. If one tries to possess it, one loses it. Therefore, sometimes things flourish, and sometimes they do not. Sometimes life is hard, and sometimes it is easy. Sometimes people are strong, and sometimes they are weak. Sometimes you get where you are going, and sometimes you fall by the way. The sage is not extreme, extravagant, or complacent. This one's called virtue. Who understands the world is learned. Who understands the self is enlightened. Who conquers the world has strength. Who conquers the self has love. Who is contented has riches. Who is determined has purpose. Who maintains his home will long endure. Who maintains his influence will live long after death. The next one I'll read too is really interesting. It's called Tao Favors No One. Infinite Tao flows everywhere, creating and destroying, implementing all the world, attending to the tiniest details, claiming nothing in return. Though it does not control them, it has no intention. So it seems inconsequential. It is the substance of all things. Though it does not control them, it has no exception. So it seems all important, because it favors no finite thing. It is infinite. This is nice, overcoming the impossible. The soft overcomes the hard. The formless penetrates the impenetrable or impenetrable. Therefore, I value taking no action, teaching without words, work without action, are understood by no one. It's really interesting. He talks here of love. He goes, Tao bears us, love nurtures us, nature shapes us, circumstances complete us. We worship Tao and honor love. for worship of Tao and honour of love are performed by being alive. Tao bears us. Love nurtures, develops, cares for, shelters, comforts, and makes a home for us. Making without controlling, giving without demanding, guiding without interfering, helping without profiting. This is love. It's very beautiful. This one is on emotions. I'm being inspired, so I'm just keeping on going until I feel to stop. Emotions. Because the sage follows Tao, his emotions do no harm. I'll reread that because I didn't quite get the rhythm. Because the sage follows Tao, that's T-A-O, his emotions do no harm. It is not that they lose their power, but that they do not hurt others. Because they do not hurt others, he does not hurt others. Because his emotions do no harm, all his relations with people are loving. That's really lovely. Here's one on confront difficulty. Practice no action. Attend to do nothing. Taste the flavorless. Examine the small. Multiply the few. Return love for hate. Deal with difficulty while it is yet easy. Deal with the great while it is yet small. The difficult develops naturally from the easy and the great from the small. So the sage, by dealing with the small, achieves the great. He who finds it easy to promise finds it hard to deliver. He who takes things lightly makes things hard. The sage confronts difficulty and so has none. And the next one's called accept responsibility, which I think is really, really important in our world. Nothing in the world is as yielding as water, nor can anything better overcome the hardest, the hardened. Just as the yielding overcomes the hardened, the weak may overcome the strong. Yet they do not, the sage says. Who accepts responsibility for his people rules the country. Who accepts responsibility for the world rules the world. But his words are not understood. So that's a few. They have mentioned here that this is from selections of various translations, one of which is Richard Wilhelm, and that's W-I-L-H-E-L-M. Also, Aleister Crowley was another translator. The translations are very important because obviously it's translating from Chinese to English and meanings can be lost. And when you're dealing with wisdom, it's coming from a very deep space. And I guess unless you have Chinese as your first language, you're probably not really going to feel the true meanings in the Chinese characters. But I think in this English version, we get a bit of a sense of the emptiness, of the not doing, of the beingness, of love being the goal in many respects. Well, love is really the essence of the Tao. It's really wonderful. And when I first read this, I was really, really inspired. And I knew this was the way that I have to go in my life. And even today, I'm coming to this more and more. And it's really about the emptiness. It's about living without desires. In the sense of you're not allowing the ego to sort of move you. You're allowing yourself to surrender to life. My understanding is to let go and to surrender and to heal any hurt or pain from one's life. And everyone is carrying wounds from their childhood and throughout their life. Most people are suppressing those emotions, and it tends to come out in distortions of how we see others. And that's why they talk about purity. Everyone in truth is pure at their core essence. It's just that over our lives, we've had that many things that have covered over us in terms of beliefs, in terms of even morality, things that have been imposed on us in order to see the world in a certain way. My understanding of these types of teachings is that they are to create greater clarity, to bring simplicity into understanding, and ultimately really even let go of words and beliefs so that one comes into the stillness of life. And they call that the beingness. And it doesn't mean that you're going to sit and meditate for years and years. It actually means from that stillness, great creativity arises. And your true purpose in life naturally flows, just as a river would flow to the sea. It's very natural. It's effortless. That's when you know you're in harmony with your true nature. And going back to the poem that I wrote, this Eastern mysticism came up when I was writing the poem. That's why I spoke about the sage. And that's how I connected to Lao Tzu, which I'm sharing with you now. I saw the wisdom of energy being balanced and people questioning their projections. And I saw the North Korean leader and, you know, the American president as mirroring one another. Both were educated and indoctrinated with attitudes of dominance and control. And it's, to me, not surprising that the two have actually come together. They've been drawn together. And what they say in sort of from a mystical perspective is like attracts like. Often they're drawn to each other because of resistance within both. So the Eastern mysticism or the wisdom of the East talks about non-resistance, non-attachment, allowing oneself to flow with the energy of the other, which is creating a harmony, not a resistance. It's the resistance that brings on the warfare. Harmony doesn't mean surrendering in the sense of losing your dignity. It actually is the opposite. It's retaining your dignity through recognizing your own virtues and making decisions from those virtues, such as compassion, such as truthfulness, such as unity, such as peace. Those virtues will create greater clarity in one's vision. And that then helps create the pathway out of the conflict. And that really is my message for the North Korean leader and the American president. If they want to de-escalate the violence and conflict, they have to find a way to recognize aspects of themselves in each other and find ways to meet in the middle with one another. Find out what the true problem is in respect of the nuclear genie. One cannot ask the other to give it up if it itself is housing nuclear. Perhaps it could lead by example and move away from nuclear and move more towards diplomacy and dialogue and understanding. So rather than having departments of defense, maybe there's ways we can create departments of conflict resolution and we start to resolve all conflict globally. I think the US could be a great leader if it recognizes its true power is actually within its own wisdom of life, liberty, and not only the pursuit of happiness, but actually being happy. So that's what I would like to share. Anybody wants to look at my work? My belief is that we need to educate the children in peace and nonviolence in order to prepare a new generation for a renewable earth. You can go to www.worldpeacefull.com, or if you're interested in anti-bullying training in organizations where we can explore virtues, values, conflict resolution, learning how to own our issues and how to share a space with others who are very different. Really recognizing the basis of power and the roots of conflict, is essential if we want to create a more peaceful world. It's in seeing ourselves in each other that true peace arises. And the last thing I will leave you with is what I typically write, what you resist persists, what you look at disappears. We are indeed one world and one family. So I send everybody peace and joy, and may we all be the change we wish to see in the world. Thank you. Bye.